Morsenal Studio B in Chandler, Arizona, this is MayaCast. Welcome to another edition of MayaCast. I'm your host, Tom Shadle.
And I'm your host, Kip Parcell.
And this is episode 295 for Friday, October 9th, 2020. Give it away, give it away, give it away now. Coming up on today's show, we are giving out lots of boxes and blisters to some lucky listeners. We are doing all of the MayaCast Masterclass Quarter 3 winners from our Girl Power theme. We will, of course, after all that, announce the new theme for Quarter 4. In case you're interested in participating next time. And then we also have our Patreon supporters. We have the three winners of that to give away as well. So a lot of prizes to give out today on the show. We're going to talk about the entries and give some shout-outs there. And so if you haven't seen the gallery, go to MayaCast's Facebook page. And I think it's facebook.com/MayaCast. And then it should be a pinned post, the gallery of our 116 entries that we received for the Girl Power contest. So go check it out. And if you can pull it up while you're listening, you can follow along and look at all the pictures as we talk about them. Before we do that, however, Kip, we're going to touch on some of those N4 rules. You know, we said, hey, if you notice anything we didn't, let us know, or if you understand why double shot exists, which it happens to be a really obvious answer. And so we had some people write in.
Nice.
And so the first person is Thomas Brandt. Okay. And he says, very cool show last week. I don't know if I missed it, but crazy koalas and other perimeter weapons don't run along with their troopers anymore, but are simply placed in zone of control around them. Very major change for me as a nomad player. Greetings, Thomas. Shooby-dooby-doo.
Shooby-dooby-doo-wop-pop-pop-pop. No, that is a huge change. Oh, sorry. I just had to add that in.
Four U's. Yeah. In fact, we got done recording the one time and we got done. I was like, oh, damn it, Kip. I forgot to talk about the perimeter weapons.
Yeah.
So that is a change for crazy koalas and mad traps, mm-hmm. right? You used to deploy them with you at the beginning. They would move along with you. You'd have to put them in standby mm-hmm. once you wanted them to, you know. And, now they're basically like mines or like wild parrots or fast pandas.
I was going to say it's more like wild parrots and fast pandas. And then like, I know, right? Sorry, I'm fixing my little mohawk here. Tom was making fun of me. It was quite hilarious. It's not, you know, that's how radio works because people can't see you.
You got
doing
the Elvis
that.
Pompadour going on.
I do. It's pretty funny. Just got back from vacation and I have like the 2-day no shower hair going on and beached out. I mean, like when I read it, I was like, wow, that's kind of significant change. But to me, it made sense because you're like, how can you have fast pandas and wild parrots that are pretty much are supposed to work like the way koalas were? So the way they were going to kind of blend it was they had to choose one or the other, like either wild parrots and, fast pandas were going to work like current day koalas and mad traps or vice versa. And I think that it was just a lot cleaner and easier to do it the way they did, but it does make them far less scarier.
Yeah. And now the people with
for sure.
The people with crazy koalas, instead of just deploying two of them in zone of control during deployment, now they have the mind layer skill, so they can start with one deployed, but it's going to stay wherever they put it. It's not going to move along with them like it used to. And then if they want to put a second one down, then they have to, spend a short skill to, place deployable and launch it out into their zone of control. So, not the same. I think it's cleaner and easier as far as, the confusing standby rules and mm-hmm. when will it go off, when won't it? Well, now it'll just go off when an enemy is within 8 inches. You don't have to worry about standby.
Yeah, exactly.
And so
That was a messy one too. And I mean, it's still better than a mine because it doesn't need to have actual line of fire to the model. So it's, you know, yeah. It's that intuitive mind that just jumps on people.
Mm-hmm. So yeah. Thank you, Thomas. Big change. And then Greg Fawcett writes in. He says, "Hi, chaps. Loved your two-part N4 rules review. It was a great summary of the changes, including a couple of points. Where's my mind? A couple of pints. Points I hadn't spotted on my initial read-through. Something I did spot regarding Impetuous that you didn't mention was what happens if you have an Impetuous model who makes it to the enemy deployment zone and there are no enemy models within its movement range. I have an image of a Datarazzi reaching the far side of the board and then panting like animal after a drum solo, wondering what to do next. Maybe a corner case that won't come up very often, but it did stick with me. Keep up the good work, Greg, a.k.a. Storm Shroud." Yeah. So it's a good point.
Yeah.
Impetuous. You know, get into base contact with an enemy in your zone of control or move towards the enemy deployment zone. What happens when you're at the enemy deployment zone?
I imagine.
Now what do you do?
I imagine that, like, once you get to the enemy deployment zone, it acts like checkers, and you're like, queen me, and you can just move however you want. right?
You swap out your Datarazzi for an Anathematic.
Yeah, there you go.
King me.
That's even better. I like that even better.
You get all the way across the table. Yeah, no answer for that.
No, don't know what to tell you. I mean, if I were to have to make the TO ruling, I'm like, at this point there is no ruling. So as long as you're stay within their deployment zone, you can move wherever you want because you are moving towards a part of their deployment zone. That's why I was joking about you can start moving backwards and stuff like checkers. Like it's like, no, like when you're in the deployment zone, move however you want, my man or my women. For any of our lovely ladies and girl power listeners out there. That would be because they're that until we get an FAQ on that. There's no real right answer.
Yeah, no idea. Hilarious, though.
It is. I don't think it's too much of a corner case either. Like with
their, they get on their comm log and they're like, boss, boss, I did it. I did it. Boss, I did it.
Start running east and west.
I guess. Yeah, I don't know. So that's funny. And then William Weiser writes in. Says, "Hey, Tom, I could be missing something. I've only played one game of N4 just yet, but I think I have an answer to your confusion about double shot." And I don't know how we didn't like think of this on the spot, Kip, because it's so easy and simple. +1 B modifiers on a profile or weapon are only usable in the active turn, a thing we've said many times.
Oh, that's
but
true.
But the additional burst from the double shot trait does not appear to have that stipulation. I believe that trait exists to allow CB to create weapons or profiles that can have burst 2 in ARO. It only seems to be on chest mines and mine dispensers right now, so those weapons will have a burst 2 in ARO without needing to be in a fire team. It's not a big deal right now, but the rule existing gives CB the option to add the trait to certain weapons to give different profiles more reactive firepower." Yes, William. Exactly. And that's the email I printed out. A couple other people pointed that out as well. Plain as day. Obviously, the difference between that and +1 burst on the weapon is it works in both active and reactive instead of just active, like the parenthetical +1 B.
Good freaking catch.
So, yeah.
It's those little details, man. It's all in the details.
So, yeah, keep them coming. We're enjoying it. It's, you know, all trying to figure out this thing together. It's great. So, thank you very much for the feedback, and keep sending them in. And anytime you want to turn the notifications off on your phone, Kip, would be great.
No, I was like, can you hear that? Can you hear that? What it is it's Kalani's iPad, because I'm recording in a different part of the house. So, I'm going to run over there and turn it off. Because that's Kenzie getting text messages through Kalani's iPad.
All right. Well, we will, while Kip is doing that, we will go ahead and get right into all of the MayaCast Masterclass results.
Ladies and gentlemen, The MayaCast Masterclass.
Entries, 441 pictures. You guys rocked it out for the girl power theme for MayaCast Masterclass quarter three. So thank you so much to everyone for submitting. And there's a little headache getting the gallery up because Facebook was being a b-hole.
Nice.
And wouldn't allow me to upload pictures, and then it would allow me to upload pictures for like 5 minutes and then say, "Nah, we're done," for like an hour, and then I could upload some more an hour later. And so it was real dumb this time. But eventually we got all of the pictures uploaded, and and we had our earliest "my entry isn't appearing" question while the first batch was still physically uploading pictures. So that is, I don't think that can ever be beat. That was clearly the earliest it's ever happened. So that was great.
Was that Steve?
I don't know who it was.
I just saw Steve Schmidt, and I'm giving you a shout out, Mr. Steve Schmidt, Utah man. I just saw it when I was driving. I was like, oh no. Or maybe it was late last night.
But yeah, last first night, batch Mexico still uploading. Always a blur. And there had to be, like, I think I had to do it in 12 batches or so to get them all up there. And then had to go through and enter the names again after they were all up. It was fun.
Damn, Tom.
But got them all up. 441 pictures, 116 entries. They're awesome. And so as we are wont to do, we're going to talk about some entries that stuck out to us for one reason or another. And I'm going to start with Tomas Kaz. And disclaimer for this whole segment, we're going to butcher your names.
Yeah, I know, right? Me especially.
Even the easy American ones, we can probably screw up somehow, right?
I just do that on purpose, just to make everything
no
clear.
Disrespect is meant. We're trying our hardest to do the best that we can, and apologize. But Tomas Kaz did a Kodaly, and I thought the skin tones were just out of this world.
Mm-hmm.
Really nice skin tones on her face and her hair tentacles, right? On her Kit Fisto hairdo. So really like the skin tones. The reflective green goggles were real great, you know? All of his blacks and metallics were really well done. I really enjoyed that entry from Tomas.
That was also my first one because it was definitely one of the front runners, honestly, as these were coming in for me, for those same reasons. Like, all of the non-metallic metal was doing really, really, really well. One thing I did want to point out is when we do set these for your entries, and we give you that, hey, you have four pictures. He did that perfect multi-shot, but edited it into one picture.
Collage.
Yeah, collage in a manner that was very easy to see all of the angles that he wanted to do. So thank you for that. Because that's encouraged if you can practice that, do a couple of them, because it allows you to get multiple angles that you want the model seen at, you know, within that four. So I really wanted to point that out because he did it very, very well. Like, hey, here's my glowy bits on my gun, you know, into the jewel, which looks really, really freaking cool to me. Again, what Tom said with the skin tone and the little tattoos and the eyes and the glasses, telling you, man, for my opinion and judging, you were right there. And it was very, very difficult because well, freaking played, my friend. This is a work of art.
I wanted to give a shout out to, there's an entry of a Toha riding a motorcycle with some Symbiomates on the base.
Yeah.
And it was in pinks and light blues, right? Reds and greens. And, this was painted by Abby Strain, age 8.
Oh, I didn't even know that.
And her dad painted together, Jeff Strain, and So he said it was a real great father-daughter bonding moment, and she did a great job, and it's awesome that she entered, and I loved it. I love the two-tone pink on the bike.
Mm-hmm.
You know, very eight-year-old girl on brand. Dig it a lot.
Yeah, totally. Jeff, that's amazing, man. Give her a shout-out. I actually missed his email, so it must have been... Hopefully it was in the last 5 days, because if not, then I really suck. But that's one of the few I miss of these coming in, so I didn't even see that was his daughter's. That's absolutely fantastic. I love that he does that with her. Jeff obviously is somebody that we've met multiple times at different conventions, like Rumble or Gen Con. They're from Canada. Him and Olin, they're really awesome dudes. And I love that, you know, they do family time, hobby time.
And he said she could pick any of his models that she wanted to paint.
Mm-hmm.
And so she chose this authorized bounty hunter conversion that he had made.
So freaking awesome, dude. Oh, so man. No, that's love fantastic. To see it. Yeah, those are some of my faves when it's family time. I want to give out, you know, I was poking fun at our good friend Steve from up in Utah, because you're awesome, man. I'm going to go to another Utah man, Alan Emlett, Zoe. Really, really good, my man. See, he's such a good painter. So it's funny because, you know, Alan does a lot of like judging and helping out with like organizing tournaments. I don't see him play a lot, even though I know that he does, or paint. And then he just is like, oh, I'm going to start painting it. And you're like, holy crap, dude. Like, you're extremely freaking talented. Like, you got some skills. So yeah, he did Zoe, AKA Angelina, and love the two-tone hair. All the blends are freaking on point. Love the purple gun to match the cyberpunk hair. And again, kudos for using photo editing techniques, because we got the two singles, which shows, you know, the front and the back. That's cool. So then you did like the collage with some certain points close up on the head, and then basically the 360 view all in one picture. So it's like, that was clever, you know, very, very intuitive. To show off your entire model within the four picture parameter. So dude, top freaking notch, my man.
Yeah, real nice and clean. Really good job. Mm-hmm. His came in real early, and he was a definite leader in the clubhouse real early on.
Mm-hmm.
oh
yeah.
So Ben Counter did a Hippolyta, and what I really liked about his Hippolyta was the freehand detailing along the edge of her skirt that mm-hmm. mimics the detailing that's sculpted into the belt.
Yeah.
So I thought, you know, it's very tiny and nice and precise and fits. So I liked his Hippolyta a whole lot.
With the whole H, the Aleph H on the arm mm-hmm. too. another one that stood out to me just because of really good blends and, shiny bits, was Arsene's Ninja. Plus it was like the purple and teal. It's like if like the Denver Broncos and the Miami Dolphins had a baby, for the color palette to me. It's football season. Sorry, my mind goes that way. Plus, I really liked the base and the shrubbery that was added to it. So I wanted to give a shout out because a lot of good blends in there. I know how intricate that model is because it's a female ninja. There's some tiny, tiny parts on there. So I'll never put that in anything that's not magnetized. So well played.
Speaking of cool color schemes, I like Brian Jones' color palette on his Bit of Bit and Kiss fame.
Yes.
I love the green he achieved on these sort of overlapping strappy skirt and leggings and bodice. And then the details on the face, speaking of tiny little details that are hard to paint,
mm-hmm.
he really got the weird combined army face details, nailed those too. But I really liked the color he got with that green.
Yeah, it's very glowy. It's like straight out of Aquaman. I actually was calling her the Jade Princess. Huh? It like looks like a jade stone. Yeah, really, really good job. My next one, and I'm trying to scroll down to it really fast just to keep up with my notes, was from Dano. I hope it's Dano or not Dano. But it's one of the twins, you know, the Coon Biker twins.
Mm-hmm.
And my favorite thing about this was all of the pictures were taken in this really cool, like, photo box that looks like the back alley with all this really awesome graffiti, like the female white Spider-Man from Into the Spider-Verse. Yeah, Spider-Gwen. Plus some other, and please forgive me if I don't recognize the other pictures that they're from, but all that graffiti, that's amazing, because that's what taking, you know, that's setting the tone and the parameter. And yeah, you might, you know, the model might not be to, you know, like Tomas and Alan's skill level yet, but that's not why we do this. We do this for participation and practice. And that right there stood out to me. Like, so this is one of the models that I think is freaking amazing just because of the creativity on, how to place and take pictures. So coup freaking does, Dano.
Yeah. Hakan Jansson, right? So mm-hmm. he did a Shinobu Kitsune who appears as if she is removable from her base. So when she's a TO camo marker, it's just the base with a splash on it.
I know exactly what you're talking about now.
As she's running through the... Well, it's just like Ghost in the Shell.
Yes, it's very Ghost in the Shell.
Running invisibly, and you see the splashes where the footfalls are, and then you can plug the Shinobu in to the middle of that water effect. So,
dude, I didn't even catch that. That's amazing.
I thought that was super, super cool.
Dude, that's 100% super cool. I totally didn't even catch that. I saw that and I was like, wait, what? But again, I was rushing, so I'm a horrible person. I wanted to give a shout out to Dave Holiday because I really liked his Valkyrie. It's one of my favorite models that Chorus has actually made in a while. It trumped the Merc Hacker, one of my War Driver that I actually made part of my Druids because it looked just like Kenzie, my wife. Because it had like the side braids, so I painted mine like that. But then this came out, and I was like, "Oh man, this is more of one that I would want to paint like Kenzie, because she likes to do all kinds of crazy braids in her hair like this." But I mean, the paint job's solid; it's very, very clean. You can tell that there's an understanding of non-metallic metal, so I think the gold looks really, really good, and I love the tattoos and the you know, ground to sky. Reflective chrome on the glasses. I'm always a fan of that, so wanted to give you a shout out there, my man. That's gonna be my theme right now.
Jacob Solis did an absolutely outstanding Code Dolly.
Mm-hmm.
Love the strappy armor bodysuit color palette he's got going on, and you know, and just all of the colors were really smart. Like that the blue that he used, the sort of bluish green that he used for that bodysuit, you know, opposite mm-hmm. of the color wheel from the orangish red that he used for his base, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it also plays nicely with the reddish purple hair. Well, hair.
Yeah.
Kit Fisto braids. but yeah, and the lighting on that bodysuit is spectacular. Like, it's a really, really outstanding job on this Code Dolly. Like, all the Kodalis, man.
I know, right?
But yeah,
they killed it.
Jacob Solis, beautiful job. Love that Kodali a lot.
Yeah, again, this is another one that was like top class in the running. I agree with Tom with all of that. You know, I love the shading of every little panel. It was done superbly. And you know what else stood out to me? That it seems like it's probably was like the easiest part of this model to do, but has a huge effect, was just the base, you know, that orange to black in like the, cause he knew he wanted to take a picture on this mat. So it legit matches the game mat that he probably plays on all the time. So again, just like I was talking about, with Daniel's, like, this is superb picture taking ability as well, because you actually set the atmosphere. Like, I feel like I'm in this world, not just looking at a model that's also superbly painted. So that was one of my other favorite things, other than, you know, I completely agree with Tom on every other aspect of that model. So well freaking done, man. My next one, it's funny you mentioned his daughter. I wanted to give a shout out to Mr. Jeffrey Strain himself, because it's, I love this. And it's funny because I totally screwed this up. So I'm going through with these models and I put Uma, but that's not Uma.
I have to scroll to it. Hang on.
It's the orc character. The orc character.
Oh, Patsy Garnett.
Yeah, it's Patsy. So gonna say Patsy. but I like Jeff does a lot of these like cool flags, so that's always really cool to see. But what my favorite thing about this was all the freehand work. Like, I love when people do the sci-fi guns. You know, add all that extra like stripies and lines on it, with like the unit markers. So that was my favorite thing about this. Like, the model's painted pretty clean. I love the fades, you know, and all the shading that's doing, and like the standout little glowy bits. But it's all the freehand work that actually I liked a lot, that gave it a lot of character, especially since it is a character. So I want to give you a shout out, my friend.
I like that the stars on the flag are like in the style of the Australian flag.
Yeah.
So the next one I wanted to point out was by Jess Hodges. Okay. And this is a Yijing doctor. Yixing, I think. So what I like about this, it is very precise and it's very clean, very sharp. Mm-hmm. You can make out every detail from far away, right?
Yeah.
And the thing is, like, so the red armor plates, for example, might not have as much, or the white cloth might not have as much depth in contrast, like I was talking about with Jacob's Kodali, right?
Yeah.
On those armor plates, where they go from really, really dark to really, really bright, and the contrast really makes it pop. It doesn't have that amount of contrast, right? And so what I wanted to point out was, like, if you are looking like, how do I improve my painting? What is the next step I can take?
Mm-hmm.
And you're having trouble pushing the contrast. You're having trouble getting smooth blends. Well, this here shows you that's not the next step. That can come later. But to get a super clean and precise, gorgeous model that you can see all the details on, is just to be clean. Make sure that there is a dark line between every section of different colors. You know, each armor plate on the shin is separated by a dark line and then edged in a bright line, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so every detail stands out and pops, and it makes it super clean, very easy to read. You know, keeping your brush strokes even and narrow, all the same size, right? It's just very, very clean. That to me is, would be like the next step to, like, what do I do to make my personal painting better? Do the dark lining, do the edge highlighting, just keep it very neat and tidy. Right. And that's going to improve the quality of your models, greatly. And, you just need a nice sharp brush that comes to a good springy point, like any Kalinske sable brush, like a Winsor & Newton, will do the trick. And, you know, it's a time consuming and sometimes tedious step, but it really makes all the difference in the world. fancy blends or lighting effects or whatever, not so much, but super, super clean, right? No fancy tricks, just super clean.
Super clean. Now, I'll piggyback on that because that was one of mine. And I love how you and I keep having to skip some of our lists because you're like, damn it, that was my next one too. I everything Tom said, plus I like the how clean the base is because that adds character. But my biggest thing that I wanted to just add on top of everything Tom just said was the first thing that stood out to me personally was this. His palette is almost exactly the same as my old school Fire Dragons when I played Elder all the time, down to the fact that I did turquoise accents. So when I saw this, it shot me into this lovely part of my heart that still exists because it's almost exactly the same palette. So I just wanted to let you know that great minds think alike. Mr. Jess Hodges. Or Miss Jess Hodges. Miss Jess Hodges, honestly. And please let us know that we totally messed that up. But yeah, I just have to let you know that you, Jess, and I think alike. Because that literally was the same color palette. And it hit me in such a big part of my heart. Because I have a sentimental attachment to this model now. my next one that I wanted to give a big shout out to, was to, Larry Correa because
hello,
my man, I loved this Magariba Guard conversion so much. And it's like that one Dozer model that I freaking love that it just, if you look at it, it just looks boring. That is the Dozer model, right?
Ermandino
head. Oh, Ermandino. Sorry, because I was like, I want that as a Dozer. That's why I always think about that. I get my conversions mixed up. But yeah, Ermandino.
The one who's just like sitting on the crate, kicking back.
Yeah, but I love it. That
works
so much
perfectly
character.
On here.
I was like, thank you for bringing it to light because this is freaking amazing. This is classic military anime freaking awesomeness in every bit of its glory. You hit a grand slam, not even a home run, but a grand slam with this dude. Like, cool. Freaking does. He hits two frickins.
LOLOL. My favorite part of this is the name he has painted on the hull. It's the Sandwich. Sandwich! Ah! Sandwich!
I didn't even notice that. I saw sand, but I missed the witch. That's
sand
funny.
Witch.
That is fantastic. Funny. Yeah.
Jordan Breezer did a Encantamiento regular sniper.
Mm-hmm.
Back up against the brick wall, right?
Yeah.
And what I really liked was the way he made a 40 mil base with an inset so she can go into foxhole and be in her 40 millimeter base.
Yeah.
And it matches the base and it blends. So it looks like one of those hollow bases that I think Secret Weapon and maybe Dragonforge make where like there's a flat bottom and you got the tapered sides, the beveled sides, but then there's nothing inside. So you can do cool stuff with water effects like he did here. And left a 25 millimeter circle blank so he can move her in and out of foxhole. I thought that was really great. I enjoyed that. Thank you, Jordan.
No, for real. That is super, super smart. Super smart. Another shout out I want to do, and this is a really tricky thing with me, and I've seen a lot of people doing these like themes, and I could see it like sometimes they look a little too bland, but sometimes they're done really well. I've seen some really good night ops, but LeFranc with the cyberpunk, Tom, what's that hacker's name from?
Lakshmi.
Thank you. I was like, the hacker from, the Frontline Company, which is the foreign company. There you go. I was like, cause I know that's not the right name too. I'm just reading my notes because I was rushing. But yeah, when it's done well, this nighttime cyberpunk neon, or I've seen some other people online do the the night ops where they do all of the night vision. When it's done well, looks really freaking cool, you know, because it, an effect like this, it's really easy to make it look like it was lazy if you don't pull it off, right? Because you're like, well, it's just two colors, but when it's done well, it looks this freaking badass. So I had to give you some shout outs, LeFranc, because this has a lot of character. And it, again, puts you in, my favorite thing is when somebody puts me into the actual, you know, mood and mode and environment that you're trying to create. So well done.
Yeah, I dig the synthwave feel of it with the teals and the greens and the blues and the pink purple. 80s synthwave, very cool.
When it's done this well, it looks amazing.
LeFranc.
Like, yeah, looks amazing.
So, Mr. Chafee, also from Canada land. Matt Chafee also did a Magarie Bigard. And the only thing I was sad about was how small his pictures were.
Yeah.
I want them to be bigger. But Maggie, we use it as a nickname for Magariba, but it's also a nickname for Margaret, right? And so his Magariba guard's name is Atwood. And then he's got a little silhouette of a handmaid on the left armor plate thing. So Margaret Atwood wrote The Handmaid's Tale.
And so well done.
His Magariba guard is Maggie Atwood. So
that's me clapping right now for you. I didn't notice that.
We got two Magariba guards, and both of them have joke names, which I think is fantastic.
Yes.
The Sandwich and Maggie Atwood.
I love the fact that I didn't get that. I'm going to give you guys a I am an idiot on both of those for not recognizing probably the best parts of both of those models. All right, Tom.
Yeah.
I need your help again.
Okay.
Max Wachter. Wachter.
Okay.
I want to say that he could be German. Wachter.
Wachter.
Voxer. Could be Voxer. Okay. what model is that? It's the purple.
Yelena Kovac.
The white hair. There. Thank you.
Yelena Kovac.
Oh my gosh. It's the freaking Kovac model. How can I forget that one? I'm an idiot.
But in purple.
Again. But yeah, in purple. Love it though. Again, another person that really took advantage of the collage and did it well. You know, prior to this, Dmitry Bogdanov always did this really, really well, to where you could accentuate some of this. But the face, really, really well done. Looks super clean. I'm a big fan of black and purple. Again, and we're going back to 40K days twice this episode, because if you would have added bleach bone to this, same color palette as my Yulthway, because I went with the purple and black with, you know, like the super like neutral accent color. But I love purple and black, so I'm probably a little bit biased on this model, but it was well executed. It's an extremely well painted model, even down to the base. So coup freaking does. Anybody who can pull off purple, you get a high five in my book. Especially when you pair it with black.
Okay, so it's another name I'm going to butcher, but I'm sorry. Mikel Hoga? Mikel Joga? I'm going to go with Mikel Hoga. So this is another one of the female limited edition ninja models, right? Mm-hmm. With the tactical bow. Except it's Storm Shadow!
Yeah. Well done.
As soon as I saw Storm it, Shadow. I was like, that's Storm Shadow from G.I. Joe. 100%, because it's all white, black weapons. So
yeah,
I just thought that was cool.
No, it is. It was
again one of those. This is Tom and I think alike a lot, especially white, man. White's hard to paint. So if you can make it look even decent, it's amazing. all right. So this is one of my favorite models in the entire Infinity line. And she just got an upgrade to where I hope that we see her on the table a lot more. And this comes from
Mr. Ryan
McCullop. And it's Andromeda. And as I said in one of my other ones, pulled off a really, really nice purple. But this one was against that bone color. So, yeah, you got a little bit of kit bias here because it's purple, black, and, like, you know, like a nice, like, bone to white, which I just freaking love that combination. Always have, always will. But, again, this is pulled off really, really well. And you can see that he's starting to get that dark to white, like you tell people. And you do get that high contrast that, especially if this is on the table, it's going to look absolutely amazing. So really, really well done. Only thing I would say, maybe you're going for like the dark base so that it didn't take away from the model. But, you know, a little bit of sand, make an asphalt, because you could actually have done like maybe a... like a spotlight sort of effect that would actually draw people into the model. So that's my only, I don't even say gripe because I love it and it's Andromeda. So I'll get over the fact that it's a solid black base. But that would be like my only suggestion.
So Sam Benson is back with an entry. He hasn't been around for a while. And he gave us a great version of the Tabitha Lyons cosplay Neoterra Bolt model, complete with drop bear. And this is, speaking of contrast, this is an excellent example on how you can get contrast to work for you, because the hard parts, the armor parts, they're very shiny, right? They go from very, very dark to very, very bright with some, almost white highlights to indicate reflection, which is pulled off because of the very, very dark shadows. So they look very, very, metallic or... glossy ceramic or whatever, right? But at the same time, her like wetsuit, her bodysuit underneath, he doesn't take the highlights as extreme or as large, and so you get a really clear differentiation between what is cloth and what is a hard surface, right? And so he does an excellent job with that, and one of the best entries of the contest is this Tabitha Lyons Bolt.
Yeah, no, it's funny. I was laughing. I keep giving Tom thumbs up when we hit the same one. I also just want to put everything Tom said, because it's done to the absolute superbness that you could take a model. But I'm kind of a little base slut. I've talked about it on the show to where sometimes I'll just make bases to try to get effects because it's soothing to me. And the base you did on the Sam is just freaking cool. I don't know if that's something, it looks like it'd be something that you just buy. But even if it is, you pulled it off to where it looks really freaking fantastic. Like with the cracked, dirt or even clay,
concrete or whatever
concrete, but it's one of the model is painted to perfection, but I mean, I always pay attention to bases, so that stuck out to me, because I'm a base slut. All right, Tom, I have one more that I was going to give a shout-out to, other than our winner, of course. So, and I'm pretty sure we have the same one for our last shout-out, so if you want to give any more before that last shout-out, is the time. I'm not going to steal this one from you because I've stole more from you than you have from me. So you can just go right into the next one.
I'm assuming your last one then is Tor Swanson.
Yes. Well, I'm assuming that too because I saw your notes and the pictures you sent me.
Oh, okay.
So I knew what your last one was.
LOL, Tony Macchiana.
Yeah, yeah.
So Girl Power, he's got... the post-Norkius brain blast hospital room of the corpse of Tony Macchiana in like a little stasis tube. So like totally scratch-built little terrain scene. He's got the Alive logo up on the monitor screen with the like static like they hacked into the hospital display. And just like... with the clear. I wish there was one more shot where you could see, like, in there was a close up of the container itself where the body is, but it's just completely splattered with blood.
Yeah, it's so good.
So, yeah. So,
and
fantastic.
I love her boots, like her boots empty over boots by the locker. It's like, come on, dude, are you kidding me right now?
She like, didn't even die with her boots.
No, it's so good. And I'm hoping, because the way this looks, like, this looks like it could be a section of one of those, of like an interior table to where, like, because Guillermo has one like this where it's all these little sections that plug together. So this is like the corner of the table for like an interior space table or interior building. I'm hoping that that's this, because that's absolutely fantastic. So good, Tony. I mean, so I almost said Tony. So good, Tor. thank you again. Like, we need more Tor.
Tony and Tor. It looks like the bottom of the stasis chamber, the blood chamber, is like half of an infinity base.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You can see the little magnet mount.
Yeah. Oh, it is. Yeah. It totally is.
So totally scratch built. Excellent job, Tor. Thank you for bringing me joy and entertainment. Mm-hmm. And that's what we like to see. Makes it all worth it. So I hope everybody got as much of a kick out of that entry as we did.
Yeah.
So that brings us to our winner.
Yes.
I guess.
Without further ado.
So, right. The winner of the MayaCast Masterclass Quarter 3 Girl Power and winner of a customized engraved either pint glass or rocks glass with the Master Glass logo designed by Tim Tulin engraved in it. You can have your name on there, your ITS name, whatever you want. The winner of that best painted, best in show prize is the Zon Nautica painted by Steve Garcia.
Mm-hmm.
And damn, this thing's dope.
Yeah, it is, man. I mean,
masterful placement of light and shadow.
Yeah, he's really good at that.
And I mean, the color shifting helmet.
Yep.
Right. And I don't mean using color shifting paints, right? That like he did that with normal person paints and made it look color shifting.
Normal person paints.
I mean, look at the red on that gun casing. You want to talk about pushing contrast, light to dark, to create a dramatic and stunning effect. Just look at the red on that gun casing and how it goes from so dark to so light. It's beautiful. Just so much contrast that makes everything pop. And the cool little water effects as the tire's skidding through a little puddle.
Yes. Are you kidding me right now? That was one of the things. I just told you guys I'm a little base slut, so we can talk all day about the model, but the base itself, those water effects, I was like, are you kidding me right now with that slidingness? But also I like the base that he selected because it has that natural curvature because that's how they built it. So the model's up in there, so it actually gives you the feel that this Zon Nautica is making this really hard, sharp turn.
Because
it's around the curve of, like, whatever drainage ditch, which, oh, there's holes there. It's probably a drainage ditch, so let's make this one in the rain. so that's what I imagine, is it's raining, and this bike is sliding along that, so, like, that's a well-placed model on a base and just adding those little effects. But this is very, very vintage Steve. Steve is just, dude, you're a pro, man. You've got this down to perfection. The non-metallic gold on everything, absolutely fantastic. Go ahead.
A masterclass on contrast.
Yeah. Just
study and examine this and zoom in and just drink in all the details and see how it can go from black to white in such a tiny amount of space
when
the color is neither black nor white. And all the little details, like the extra little scratches and pit marks, to make it feel lived in and used a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a wonderful, wonderful entry. It's gorgeous. I cannot wait to see the robot version of the bike.
I know, right? That's what I want to say. I was like, man, we should have gave two. And hey, by the way, I also wanted to give him a shout out because I know that he had to rush this because he sent us a message asking when the deadline was and he had to finish two papers before he painted this. So if you want to talk about dedication, I was like, dude, you got to, you know, when Tom puts the thing up, which is probably going to be after the, you know, after October 2nd.
Took 2 days to get all the pictures up.
Yeah, I know. Plus the 2 days. Yeah. So, I'm happy that you finished your two final essays, for school and do this. It's like, wow, what am I doing with my life?
So really, really gorgeous entry. Congratulations, Stephen. And thank you for blessing us with this fantastic model. And thanks to all 116 participants. And while Steve will win the master glass this time around, engraved with his name, whatever he wants put on there, we give out random prizes selected from amongst all participants. And now we're going to give those away. So with 116 entries, we are giving away 3 box sets and 4 what? Blister packs. Now, here's the thing. We also have an unopened, brand new, shiny, fresh copy of the N4 rulebook that just came out that some of you may be still waiting for on shipping delays and whatnot. Mm-hmm. Well, we've got one. And any of the 3 box winners, if you instead would like the N4 rulebook, okay, the first one to say that they want that instead, we'll send you that instead of a box. Okay?
So good.
And so the box winners, and this is your normal standard size Infinity box, not one of the army packs or action packs mm-hmm. or anything like that, but just your standard, you know, 6 model starter or SWC box or tag or remotes or whatever, right? Standard size box. Kip?
Yeah.
Who's our first winner?
Our first winner, and we thank you for your participation, is Emil Scott. So, Emil, congrats. Thanks for entering and pushing this to the limits.
Congratulations, Emil. Any Infinity box set that you want, or the N4 rulebook, if you want that, let us know. The second winner of a box, or the rulebook, if he's first to respond, is... Oh, should have made you do this one.
I'll do
Jay?
It.
Okay. Jay Kojan.
Oh, that's way better than I would have done it. You should. We should have let me butcher that. I'll say Kokshin.
Kokshan. K-O-C-Z-A-N. J and first initial J, Kochan. Winner of a box or the book. And then the third box winner, Kip?
I'm going to go with a Mr. Jordan Brezier. Brezier? Brezier? No, it's not Brezier. Brezier.
I think I said Breezer when I Breezer. Talked about his Akon sniper.
Oh, that's, Foxhole. Yes, that's true. So Jordan Breezer Brezier. Congrats, man.
And again, we apologize for the names. Then we have 4 blisters to give away. And the first one goes to Jim Works.
I hope so.
I'm fairly confident I said it correctly.
I think that works.
Jim Works.
And the second one is going to, again, love the Ur Andromeda. But the second randomly chose by random.org blister is going to Ryan McCullough. I like when it Yay, randomly picks some Ryan of the people McCallop. That, you know, we thought did a really good job. It's fun.
Third blister goes to Tyler Day. Again, fairly confident I nailed the pronunciation. Tyler Day, winner of a blister pack.
And our last and final blister realm we chosen. And again, thank you guys for getting us over the maximum effort level. I like when we get to do maximum effort prizes for over 100. Goes to Maurice Robinson. So congrats. Congrats to all you seven amazing participants, and love your work. And then again to Steve for just putting on a clinic. That's what he does. Oh, man.
All right. So to all eight winners, please send us an email with whichever box or blister pack that you want, Steve, with whatever you want your glass to say. Steve Garcia, Steven Garcia, your ITS name, Paint God, whatever you want it to say, we'll get that engraved on your glass. And let us know if you want a rocks glass or a pint glass. Box set winners, first one to respond that they want the book instead, we'll get the book instead. So you just send us an email with which box or blister pack, whatever you want, whichever one you want, and a shipping address, please. Don't forget your shipping address. It's very important. And we would like to give a shout out to Shiv Games for helping us provide the prizes to all of these winners. So thank you to Jeff up in Utah at Shiv Games for letting us purchase our prizes from you.
You're right. that's funny.
But if you're looking, if you're in the U.S. Specifically, and are looking for a reliable online seller, if you don't have an FLGS in your area and you're looking for a reliable seller from run by a very good person that we like a lot, check out Shiv Games. I don't think he has an online store so much as an eBay store, or you can contact them on Facebook to tell them exactly mm-hmm. what you want, but very reliable and ships very rapidly. We usually get a shipping notification the day after we tell him what we want, mm-hmm. Unless he's got to order it. And he orders directly from Corvus Belli, which if you've ever done that, you know that shipments arrive in the U.S. 3 days after they dispatch them. So that's very quick turnaround time. And the factory at Corvus Belli is never out of stock. So if your distributors are lame, go straight to the source and order from there. But yeah, thank you to Jeff from Shiv Games for helping us get the prizes. Congratulations, winners. Send us those emails. Which means, Kip.
Yeah.
It is time to announce quarter four. So everybody can start getting to work. They have until the end of the year, early 2021. Provided the Earth is still here, then to get these in. And for those of you who are new and don't know what we're talking about, we do this painting contest every quarter. And we come up with a theme, some sort of theme for the entries. And you pick whatever you want that you think fits that theme. And you send us, we usually ask for a before picture so that we know it's new for the contest, because we don't want a picture of something you painted 5 years ago. Usually.
But,
right? We want you to be painting something new for the contest. We want to encourage you to get your hobby on and get something new for the tabletop done. And so that's why we have the before pictures, to prove that it's a new model, right? And then we ask for four finished photos of your fully painted model that you have renamed with your own name, and then you can number them, like Kip Parcel 1, Kip Parcel 2, 3, 4, right? And then you send all five of those photos into one single email to us. That's tom@mayacast.com.
And kip@mayacast.com.
And then at the end of the quarter, we put up a gallery with all of the entries in it. We really do appreciate when you attach those files to your email and don't paste them in line, and don't send links to Google Drive files, because it's just more difficult for us. It's not impossible. It just makes it easier for us if you just attach them to the email. So, yeah. So here's the thing. N4 just came out. It's a new edition. It's a rebirth of the game, right? It is, it's an update to N3. N3 was great.
It was.
And four, they hope to make better. They want to show off how much they've improved with this edition, right? Mm-hmm. And so to celebrate that spirit of renewal, our theme for quarter four is a little unusual compared to what we've done in the past. Our theme is repaint. Okay? And the idea is that your skills have come a long way since you started painting way back in the day, which was a what, Kip? Wednesday?
It's always a Wednesday if it was back in the day.
Your skills have come a long way since back in the day, and you may look at your older models and think, man, I really got to repaint that. It's not as good as where I am now. So this is a very unusual theme to celebrate the rebirth and the renewal of N3 to N4. We're going to celebrate the rebirth and renewal of one of your old models. So this time, for your before picture, it can be any model, any Infinity model that you want. But your before picture, we want the old version.
Yes.
And then the new version. Now, do you technically have to totally, like, do you have to strip it and repaint it or just paint over it? No. You could literally buy a new model and paint it a second time if you want to, right? But the before picture, we want the old, your old version. And then we want you to push your skills, right? And do the same model, but with an updated paint scheme. Okay? So repaint is our theme for quarter four.
But you know what I also love that it's because it's a new edition. And it didn't hit me until you said it on air, Tom. And as soon as you said, it's a new edition, I was like, you got to cool it now, sister. So I'm going to give personal bonus points for anybody whose entry can incorporate some sort of song title from New Edition, which was an 80s band with young Bobby Brown. Like, cool it now. All colors that you would consider cool. But there's a bunch of other ones that would be really
If you do
hilarious.
That insanity, please specifically say so in the email that you sent us, or else it'll go right over our heads, I'm sure.
Even though
he asked for it. But yeah, that's the thing. Like, you got old models that you're unhappy with their paint job. We want to see you be happy with your paint job and use this motivation to finally kick yourself into gear to do that repaint that you've always wanted to do. Maybe, and I don't know what wave she's in, so this example may not totally pan out in time, but maybe you've got, it could even be this kit. You've got your old Cassandra Kusanagi miniature that you have painted.
Yeah.
And then the new one from Defiance is going to come.
Oh, yeah.
So maybe your repaint is painting the more modern
the
version.
The newer.
Maybe you've got your old Fusilier from 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Like with the face, and so now you paint one of the new Fusiliers,
or one of your 5'2" Caledonian Volunteers, RIP till next month, to the standard, you know, normal size because they were short.
Tiny. but the idea is like you take the exact same model, right, and you do a new one or you repaint the old one. But first, we want pictures of the, and we may decide to put your first version up in the gallery with the repainted version, right? So that people can see, like, this is what it did, this is what it looked like, this is my new version. So if your skills have improved, we want you to show it off and get around to showing some love to some of those first models that you loved that maybe aren't up to your current standard. So that's our theme for quarter four. Little unusual, we know. Repaint, where the before picture is actually a painted model because it's the one you already have done that you want to have a second crack at. So hopefully that inspires you, hopefully that's exciting to you, and you're not like, I'm not repainting any models, I got new models to paint, right? I'm sorry if you feel that way, but I think this could be very inspirational and exciting, and I hope you're enthused by it and want to get in on the action. That's my hope anyway.
Likewise, I'm right there with you, my friend.
All right, so congratulations to our 116 entrants and our 8 ultimate prize winners for quarter 3. Girl power. I think it was a great month with lots of gorgeous stuff I'm just sitting here staring at Steve's bike this whole time.
I know he crushed it, dude.
We've been talking. So,
those are his colors, though, man. I think that's the same color scheme he did. Why can't Perseus? That crazy one who was jumping out of the airlock.
Can't remember.
Really, really good. No, I just, when I saw it, it reminded me of Perseus. So I think it was the same color tone, which I like. Because it would make sense, because it would match the army that goes with. So it's really, really awesome.
All right, so that's going to wrap it up for MayaCast Masterclass Quarter 3. Good luck with Quarter 4. We can't wait to see how you've improved, man. It's very, very exciting. Repaint is the theme for Quarter 4.
Conversation can serve no purpose anymore. Goodbye.
Well, that's going to wrap it up for episode 295, or just about. Before we go, we do want to give a shout out to all of our supporters over at patreon.com/MayaCast. And that's where you can support the show to help us be able to provide prizes for contests and the shipping of them. And, you know, our hosting services and all of the other costs and expenses that go into running a podcast. So it's free. We don't have anything behind a paywall. This is totally voluntary for those that can and want to. You're more than welcome to. We have three different pledge levels over at Patreon. You could do $1 per episode, $3 per episode, or $10 per episode. And every month we give out prizes, and it's usually, like it is this month, a blister pack for a random member of our light infantry. That's the $1 per episode. A box set for our medium infantry winner. That's the $3 level. And then the $10 per episode reward is something very, very cool. Florian Stitz, professional artist from Germany. He will do a pencil drawing of something Infinity related that you want. So, like, we had somebody select a Chibi Fide.
Mm-hmm.
We had Michael Boris select Santa Thematic, which was
it was amazing,
glorious mashup of Santa Claus and the Anathematic. You know, it can be whatever you want. He'll do the sketch. You'll get a digital copy, and then eventually the physical copy from Chemini. And so this month's winners, Kip, tell everybody who won what and stuff.
So light imagery, again, blister of your choice. And again, thank you all for your generous donations. That winner is going to be Mr. James Negus, or Negus, N-E-G-U-S, or is it O-S?
You.
Okay. So, congratulations, James. Again, email us with what you would like, what blister you would like, and we will get it, and your address, so we can actually send it to the right place, whenever you choose that. And the medium infantry winner, any box set, as same, not an army box or one of those action packs, but a normal box set, which includes tags. Tags are a normal box set. That's going to go to, I believe this is Mr. T's son, or it's John T. T. Last name is just a capital T. So John T. Congratulations for that. And I can't wait to see what this comes in as. Because the winner of the heavy infantry, which I'm going to tell you this, I think that we need to do a gallery of all of the art that has been shipped out so that people can see how amazing these are if you get to win this one. Because that just popped in my head like 3 seconds ago. The winner of the heavy infantry, so it's going to be a customized art print done specifically for you, however you want it. Infinity related goes to a Mr. Rasmus McDowell, and I'm assuming that this guy is from Sweden. because the only Rasmus I know that plays Infinity is from Sweden, and he makes trips out here quite often for big satellite events. He's an awesome dude. I hope this is the same one, because I actually don't even know his last name.
Rasmus? McDowell. Yeah. This is Rasmus.
Hey, guess what? It is Rasmus.
Wow.
Yeah, I never knew his last name. That's funny. It's just Rasmus. I know Rasmus.
So yeah, James and John and Rasmus, congratulations. Thank you so much for your support. Send us an email with what blister, box, or artwork you want, and we will get those out to you. The email is tom@mayacast.com.
And kip@mayacast.com. And Rasmus's last name is McDowell. I am an idiot.
Yeah, so thank you to all of our generous patrons over at patreon.com/MayaCast. We couldn't afford to do this out of pocket, so thank you very much for keeping the show afloat for everybody to enjoy. So, yeah, thanks, everybody. And again, you want to check it out, patreon.com/MayaCast. So quarter three is in the books. Quarter four is underway with the repaint theme. And yeah, that'll do it for episode 295. Thank you.
Oh my gosh.
What?
We're five away from our third centennial.
300, yeah.
Oh my gosh, we got to do something Spartan themed for that one. We'll do a live episode and nothing but a loincloth. That would be so bad.
We'll have White Noise come kick us in the chest into a pit.
There you go.
Thank you all for listening. Thank you, patrons at Patreon, for supporting us. And until next time, get out there and support your local game store.
To find out how you can support the show, go to patreon.com/MayaCast.
You can find us online at www.MayaCast.com.
We are on Facebook at facebook.com/InfinityMayaCast.
Follow at MayaPodcast on Twitter.
Join the MayaCast forum group on Facebook.
And as always, you can email us at tom@mayacast.com.
And kip@mayacast.com.
Thank you.